Welcome. We got a great crowd here tonight, and it's been a long day here in Denver. There's some people in the crowd who started the day with attending a memorial service for Jordan Perlmutter, who is was one of the greatest Jewish business developers, real estate developers, and philanthropists in Denver. And we're finishing the day with an incredibly outstanding program with Roger Cohn. I'm Howard Bellow, and recently I became co-chair of the J Street Colorado Executive Committee, along with Ivor, who is sitting right there. Ivor will be concluding tonight with some excellent remarks at the end of our program. And we're going to start tonight with Rabbi Mark Goodman, who is going to take advantage of the fact that tonight is the third night of Hanukkah.
Thank you, Howard. I think I'll do more than take advantage of it, but I will say just one word. Jews all around the world are celebrating tonight the third night of Hanukkah. It's a great blessing to be celebrating this wonderful holiday, specifically in this circumstance with these speakers on this topic, and you'll see why in a second. If you don't know much about Hanukkah, Hanukkah is the commemoration of a battle, of a war that was fought 2,200 years ago between the Jews and the Syriac Greeks. The quick way I'll frame it is this. The writers of the story of the Book of Maccabees wrote that they wanted commemorated the great victory in battle, in warfare, over the Syrians. And they wrote this entire idea of how the holiday should be celebrated. And then 200 years later, the rabbis who lived in Israel shortly after the destruction of the temple and a catastrophic war against the Romans rewrote the story. They said, this war, this holiday of Hanukkah, which celebrates combat and conflict and violence, it's not very Jewish. We're going to change it. So they wrote a story. And the story was about a little bit of oil that got lost and that it got found and that it lasted 8 days and that that was a miracle. And so the holiday was changed from being about conflict and violence and victory and war to being something very different in the rabbinic imagination. The rabbis had just emerged from losing a violent war, and the rabbis believed that conflict and violence was not going to be the way to solve problems in the Middle East for the Jewish people for the years to come. And so they reinvented the holiday in a completely different way, and it became around being connected to the divine, being bringing light in at a time of great darkness, and bringing joy and light and happiness to the Jewish people and peace at a time and in a historical context which is filled with war. So if you know the blessing, please join with me. And if you don't, please enjoy as we sing together. And pardon me as I reach. Remember to speak to the microphone and light with the candle. Baruch atah Adonai, Eloheinu melech le'olam, asher kidshanu b'mitzvotav, v'tzivanu lehadlik ner shel Chanukah. Baruch atah Adonai, Eloheinu melech haolam, she'asa nisim lavoteinu, bayamim ha'ahem, ba'azman hazeh.
Fabulous. Thank you so much, Rabbi Goodman. Unfortunately, Saul Rosenthal wasn't able to be here tonight, And I wanted to thank Saul for all the effort he's done in the last 4 years in getting our Colorado chapter up to where we are today. And he has done a tremendous job, and so we can move forward from there. I'd like to go over what we can expect tonight from our program. We're going to start with Professor Nader Hashemi, who's the director of the Center for Middle East Studies at DU, is going to introduce our speaker and our panelists. Then the illustrious Roger Cohn will illuminate us with his remarks on the topic for tonight, the future of American diplomatic leadership in Israel and the Middle East. Roger will then be joined on stage with Jeremy Ben-Ami, the president of J Street, Ambassador Gary Grappo, with Professor Nader Hashemi, asking the distinguished panel several questions, and then he will field questions from the audience. Afterwards, Ivor Douglas will tie the event together with his eloquent and intelligent closing remarks. Roger Cohn's latest book, The Girl from Human Street, will be available for sale afterwards, and Roger will be signing copies also. And in addition, we're going to have a delicious dessert reception afterwards for those who care to stay. On a more personal note, my wife Jackie and I were blessed to have recently joined J Street on a leadership trip to Israel with three members of Congress, Jeremy, several of his staff members, and 15 other J Street community leaders from around the United States. The trip can be summed up in one event that took place. We were at a dinner with Israeli business leaders, and one of the Israeli business leaders pulled me aside and said, "Mr. Bello, time is running out. We are in a crisis. We need a peaceful two-state solution, and we need it soon, or I am afraid that Israel will no longer exist." And after spending 8 intensive days seeing many perspectives of this most complex situation, time is running out, and I can't wait to hear what Roger Cohn has to say tonight. J Street's fortunate to have two very energetic volunteers, Elaine Selzberg and David Wall, who have put this event together. And of course, the event would not have been possible without Danny Postel and Tiffany Wilk from University of Denver, who really made this the logistics of the event happen. Professor Nader Hashemi, who in close cooperation with the University of Denver really made this event happen by putting together this panel, and he has been a very, very close working advocate with J Street, and this is actually the third event that we have worked together with him on. And I would like, he is a longtime friend of Roger Cohn, so he is the perfect person to do the introduction. Professor?
Well, thank you everyone for coming tonight. Thanks to J Street for their hard work. Roger, it's an honor to have you on our campus tonight. I'm not sure if Roger actually remembers the first time that we met, but we actually met in the context of the struggle for democracy in Iran, when Roger was one of the last foreign journalists in Iran in 2009 during the Green Movement protests, and he wrote eloquently and passionately in defense of the aspirations of the pro-democracy protesters, and we were very happy to have his writings included in the edited volume on that topic that Danny Postel and I put together. And it's also special to have Roger here during Hanukkah, which is the Festival of Light, because Roger Cohn is, I think, a light who's illuminating a lot of the darkness in our world today, particularly with respect to the Middle East. There's always something there to learn from, to admire in his writings and his interpretation of the very difficult challenges that face our world today. In terms of his official biography, Roger Cohn has worked for the New York Times for 25 years as a foreign correspondent, a foreign editor, and a guest columnist. His books include Hearts Grown Brutal, Sagas of Sarajevo, and most recently, The Girl from Human Street, A Jewish Family Odyssey, both of which will be on sale tonight. About his most recent book, The Girl from Human Street, the New York Times Book Review wrote, Cohen places the particular experiences of his family in a larger historical frame. In his instructive meditations on history and Jewish life, Cohen catches virtually the entire 20th century. Exquisite is how the Jerusalem Post called the book. Cohen writes with a poetic fragility, always striving for moral clarity, even when his own inner contradictions and complexities impede him. Roger Cohen is taught at Harvard and at Princeton, and his work has been recognized with several awards, including a Lifetime Achievement Award from Britain's Next Century Foundation and a prize from the Overseas Press Club of New York. Joining him on stage after his keynote presentation is Ambassador Gary Grappo, who is envoy and head of mission for the Quartet Group in Jerusalem, U.S. Ambassador to Oman, Minister of Council for Political Affairs at the U.S. Embassy in Baghdad, Charge d'Affaires and Deputy Chief Mission in Saudi Arabia, and also the Director of Regional Affairs for the State Department's Near East Bureau in Washington, D.C., and he's now a Distinguished Fellow at our Center for Middle East Studies here at the University of Denver. And also on stage tonight will be Jeremy Ben-Ami, who most of you know, founder of and president of J Street, and author of A New Voice for Israel, Fighting for the Survival of the Jewish Nation. He served as deputy domestic policy advisor to President Bill Clinton. The Jerusalem Post has named him one of the 50 most influential Jews of 2014, calling him a, quote, game changer on the American Jewish landscape, who has challenged the status quo by redefining the relationship between Israel and the Jewish establishment in the United States. It's a huge honor to have Roger here with us tonight, as I said. Please join me in welcoming him to the University of Denver.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you, Nader. Great to see you again. And Danny, wherever he is. Thank you, Howard. Thank you, J Street. Thank you to the University of Denver, of which I'm already somewhat in awe, having come from the Harry Potter-esque Mary Read Hall, where I had dinner, to this very striking theater. I became an American citizen a decade ago, and in that process, I had to demonstrate that I speak English, and I had to take a dictation. And so I sat down with the immigration officer, and she said, are you ready? I said, yes. She handed me a piece of paper and pronounced the first sentence, which was, I want to be a good American. I wrote out the sentence. She said it was correct. And then she said, are you ready for the second sentence? I said, yes. And the second sentence was, I plan to work very hard every day. So I immediately got some notion of what it is to be an American. But I have never, never worked quite as hard as I have for J Street in the past 3 days, in the course of which I have learned that J Street holds nothing so much in horror as a 10-minute break in your schedule. becoming an American for me was the end of a long odyssey, a long family odyssey that began in Lithuania, went on to South Africa where my parents were born. From South Africa, my parents immigrated to Britain. My dad was actually the dean of the last black residency at the University of the Witwatersrand, the finest university in South Africa, along with the University of Cape Town. And when that was shut down by the nationalist apartheid government in 1957, he said enough. He was out of there. So I spent my infancy in South Africa, raised in Britain, then part of the family, went to Israel, and part of the family came to the United States. I did. And everywhere along the way, in all the places that the family lived, there was always the slight unease of being a Jew. Whether it was the pogroms in Lithuania, which first led my parents to leave, or it was the unease of living in South Africa, where there could not but be echoes in the appalling treatment and persecution of the blacks under the apartheid system of the Jewish experience in Europe, particularly between 1933 and 1945. And also in Britain, where at least when I was growing up, it was fine to be Jewish, but one was Jewish in a whisper. I well remember sitting with my mother in a restaurant in northwest London in St. John's Wood. She pointed across the restaurant and said, you see that family over there, darling? They're Jewish. And I said, Mom, why are you whispering? She said, I'm not whispering, darling, but they are Jewish. And so everywhere there was this slight unease, this slight sense of otherness, of not quite belonging. And through this experience, and through also, of course, my professional experience, I came very firmly to the conclusion that there was and is a need for a Jewish homeland. And on that basis, became a Zionist, a strong believer in the need for a state of Israel. The question, of course, is what state of Israel? Herzl was right in 1896. Half acceptance into European society, the great emancipation of the Jews that began with the French Revolution, proved more dangerous in the end than non-acceptance, than the life in the shtetl. And not even Herzl could have foreseen the Holocaust. Well, we're meeting at a very difficult moment, a grim moment in the Middle East. But there's one more thing I want to tell you about the South African experience, which influences the way I see the issue. I was told throughout my infancy and childhood that I should enjoy the swimming pools of South Africa because next year they would be red with blood. The blacks confined in those miserable, dust-ridden, filthy, abject townships beyond the horizon would rise up and they would come to claim what was theirs. And the 4 million whites of South Africa, including my family, would be driven out. Well, it didn't happen. And why did it not happen? It did not happen because of leadership, because of statesmanship, because two men, Mandela and de Klerk, decided that the future was more important than the past, that putting food on the table for children was more important than settling scores of injustice from the past, that building a future was more important than revenge. And what has never happened in the Middle East in the Israel-Palestine conflict is managing to persuade the leaders there that it's more important precisely to put the future over the past. But having seen that in South Africa, I cannot, of course, give up on the hope that that might happen one day. And I always remember Menachem Begin, the first Likud Prime Minister of Israel, going to Camp David in 1978. And remember, he went there with one firm, irrevocable principle that he would never, under any circumstances, give up the settlements in Sinai, the Israeli settlements in Sinai. And why would he never give them up? Well, he planned to retire there. And what happened with Jimmy Carter's relentless prodding? In the end, of course, he gave up those settlements. Peace was reached between Israel and Egypt. And it's a cold peace, but it's a peace that is now held, and there has been no more bloodshed between Egyptians and Israelis. So there has to always be hope, but I don't think I've known a more difficult moment in the Middle East, or particularly in Israel-Palestine, than the present one. I'm not going to talk at length here about the complete dismemberment of Syria, and perhaps we can talk about that during the panel. But as we've discovered yet again, nobody loves a vacuum as much as a jihadi. And the emergence of the Islamic State under its black flag, with its direct threat to our freedoms, to our civilization, is one of the most potent, dangerous, and worrying threats that I think has emerged from the Middle East in a long time. And the situation in Syria is today a free-for-all. It's a complete free-for-all. You see the Sunni-Shia conflict between essentially Iran and Saudi Arabia, playing out with great intensity in Syria, probably the most intensity of anywhere in the Middle East. But of course, there is also Yemen. You see the Russians on the ground. You see Kurdish forces. You see, of course, ISIS. You see Bashar al-Assad still with his barrel bombs. And I think if Syria illustrates one thing, it's that we're at a moment of tectonic change in the global security system. If America, the United States, has underwritten global security since 1945, I think Syria illustrates that that is no longer the case to the same degree. And what is happening in Syria, I think, would have been unthinkable even 20 years ago, 10 years ago, perhaps. And I think Syria also illustrates that if interventionism and the use of American power can be disastrous, as it proved to be in Iraq, non-interventionism, hesitation, statements from the President of the United States that are then not followed up, the diminution of American credibility when red lines are set, or when the President of the United States says that Bashar al-Assad is history, he will be gone, but has no plan, no coherent plan, and no plan to make a plan to make that happen, then the undermining of America power, America's word, which after all is what the security of the world ultimately rests upon, at least in my view, that I think is a very dangerous development. And I would say to those who wish to see the diminution of American power and the end of Pax Americana around the globe, I would just say, careful what you wish for. Within Israel-Palestine, what we have today, and I said at the beginning, I'm a Zionist, but what Israel, which Israel? And what we have today in Israel is a one-state reality. Those are the words of Secretary of State John Kerry recently, and I think they are accurate. We have had a one-state reality now for almost 50 years. And I would say that Israel is a miracle of rapid development perched on the brittle foundation of coercion of another people. And for almost a half century now, Israel has exercised dominion over a disenfranchised people, the Palestinians. And the Jews, a people who for so long were strangers in a strange land, oppressed and persecuted, have made humiliated strangers of others in their own assertion of statehood. And this, I think, is not what the secular Zionist founders of Israel hoped for. It's certainly not what I hope for. And I think that what held the Jews together during all the millennia of dispersal was, in essence, a covenant. And what was that covenant? It was a covenant of ethics. And what was the core of those ethics? That which is hateful to yourself, do not do to your fellow man. And if that covenant, those ethics, only in the end proved to have been applicable when Jews were powerless, when Jews had no power, when Jews went meekly to the slaughter, but proved to be inapplicable in a situation where Israel has become a powerful state in the Middle East, I personally think that would be a sad outcome, an unfortunate outcome. What we see today is not the Israel of which the founding charter of 1948 speaks, an Israel based on freedom, justice, and peace, as envisaged by the prophets of Israel. It will ensure complete equality of social and political rights to all its inhabitants, irrespective of religion, race, or sex. It will guarantee freedom of religion, conscience, language, education, and culture. And I think the reason that the Israel of which the founders dreamed has given way to the Israel that we see today is in significant part due to the rise of the messianic Zionism, which has replaced the messianic religious Zionism that has been in ascendancy now for some decades. Israel, for me, is a state of laws. It is founded on legality. It was founded through the collective will of the nations of the world as expressed after the Holocaust, after the millennia of persecution in 1947 in UN Resolution 181, which called for the creation, you know this, of an Arab state, a Jewish state, and international supervision of the holy sites in Jerusalem. And it called also for economic union between that Jewish state and the Arab state. Believe me, it's worth reading. And maybe you'll say to me, well, all the rivers of blood that have flowed since then, beginning with the Arab armies going to war against Israel in 1948, don't they illustrate, Mr. Cohen, that that was an utterly vain and foolish wish to stipulate that in the place of Mandate Palestine, there should emerge these two states? Well, I think there's another way of looking at it. And the other way of looking at it is that every attempt, such as the one going on now, every attempt to reach some other outcome on that territory, in the Holy Land, on the land between the Mediterranean Sea and the Jordan River, is doomed to failure. And every attempt to force some other outcome is precisely what has led to that bloodshed. And I think there is a very, very fundamental difference between the notion of an Israel founded on laws. And I'm not diminishing the difficulty of the neighborhood in which Israel lives or the myriad failures of the Palestinian leadership. But the difference is absolutely fundamental between an Israel built on laws and an Israel under the influence of, and often it seems guided by, people who believe that the whole of Eretz Israel, all that land I just mentioned, is Israel's. Why? Because God said so. Because that land was deeded to Israel thousands of years ago in the scriptures. And once you start to believe that, I think you are in very dangerous territory when millions of other people live on that same land. And I think we unfortunately have to conclude that we're now at 20 years from the assassination of Yitzhak Rabin, and I personally, and I'm sure many of you, have been thinking about it. Assassinated, of course, by Yigal Amir, a follower of Baruch Goldstein, who was the killer of more than 20 Palestinians in Hebron. And that assassination, I think, has been one of the most successful in history. As a result of it, Oslo died a slow death. Messianic religious nationalism rose, reason ebbed, rage flowed, the center eroded, extremes grew. I think a majority of Israelis still want a two-state outcome, but their conviction that it's possible has diminished. And as for the Palestinians, it's hard to know what they think, because it's 10 years now since the last election. Palestinian rule is opaque, and of course it's divided between Fatah in the West Bank and Hamas, still bent on Israel's destruction in Gaza. Now, why, in all these 50 years, has Israel not asserted its sovereignty over all the territory it controls and granted the vote and other democratic rights to all its inhabitants? I think the answer is pretty simple. There are too many Palestinians on that territory. Asserting sovereignty would have meant the end of the Jewish state. So it's chosen instead the undermining of its own democracy. Israel, as Gershom Gorenstein once put it, has behaved as if the territories were part of Israel for the purpose of settlement and under military occupation for the purpose of ruling the Palestinians. I think it's very, very difficult. It's impossible to have a democracy on one side of an invisible line. And on the other side of an invisible line, all the rights of that democracy are applying to the growing number of settlers living there. And beside them, Palestinians who have no rights within that democracy, who are completely disenfranchised. And I think Israel, through the settlement movement, has undermined its Zionist founders' commitment to a democratic state governed by laws. The Talmud says, hold too much and you will hold nothing. And as Vikram Seth, the novelist, once observed, the great advantage of being a chosen people is one gets to choose who is unchosen. And you know, Yitzhak Shamir, the former Likud prime minister, once said, Eretz Israel is ours. Why? Because without any justifications, it is. And what has gone on in the West Bank over the last several years, and even since Oslo, the number of settlers has simply grown exponentially. And it's impossible, I think, for the Palestinians ever to believe that Israel is serious about a two-state outcome as long as that settlement growth continues. And Haaretz is currently running a series of articles, Haaretz, the Israeli newspaper, about the various tax-exempt U.S. entities and charities which are providing significant funding for the settler movement, which is opposed, of course, by the U.S. government. So in effect, we are granting tax breaks for contributions to organizations whose primary purpose is to send funds to support settlements and settlement activities in occupied territories. The government and we, the American public, are subsidizing activity that undermines U.S. government policy. That, I think, should not be. But of course, presidents in the United States are constrained by the political realities here. I was looking at remarks by Jim Baker, then Secretary of State, in 1991, that's 24 years ago. And he declared, "Nothing has made my job of trying to find Arab and Palestinian partners more difficult than being greeted by a new settlement every time I arrive in Israel." Well, that's 24 years ago. And of course, President Obama began his presidency with a speech in Cairo in which he was pretty firmly critical of the settlements. But given the realities here, that commitment to that line quickly eroded. And when there was a UN resolution on the settlements in 2011 that used the very words Obama had used in Cairo, the United States did not support the resolution. And I think that's where J Street comes in. J Street has come in to say that there has to be space within the United States for the Jewish community and for American politics to express a view that is firmly supportive of Israel, but is ready to raise its voice when it feels that Israel is taking the wrong course. And let's make no mistake about it. If that one state reality persists, it is impossible for Israel to remain Jewish and democratic. It simply cannot be, for the simple reason that there will very soon be more Arabs, more Palestinians on that territory than Jews. So it is critically important, and this was evident also, I think, in J Street's support of the Iran deal, an Iran deal that reduced dramatically for the first time in 15 years the number of centrifuges operating in Iran, that closed the plutonium route to the bomb, that ring-fenced and subjected to intense inspection all Iran's reduced nuclear activities. How can that be bad for Israel, ladies and gentlemen? For 15 years, Iran is barred from any progress toward a bomb, and the United States and Iran are condemned to a relationship, having had a non-relationship for such a long time, ever since the trauma of the Iranian Revolution. And it's very important, I think, that there be a voice, a space, for Jews to express these views. Because if we do not get to a two-state outcome, I think the outlook is very bad, is very grim. There should be no mistake, I think, that what we're living now in Israel, the current status quo, it's of course violent. Status quo may suggest to you stasis, maybe even something still, possibly something peaceful or quiet. No. What is the status quo in this one-state reality? The status quo is stabbings in the streets of Jerusalem. The status quo is three Gaza wars in 6 years. I was in Gaza a little under a year ago, and I stood next to the rubble of a Palestinian's home, and he had a 10-year-old daughter. And he said to me, "You know, my daughter's seen three wars in 6 years. I don't need to tell her anything. And there's a whole generation coming along that has witnessed this. And when you live in a situation where millions of people are subjected to the kind of dominion that I've described, violence is inevitable. Everything I've experienced as a war correspondent over too long now, and generally as a correspondent, suggests to me that there is a very fundamental instinct in human beings. They want to be free. It can be the blacks of South Africa. It can be the Palestinians in the West Bank. It doesn't matter. People want to be free. And if they don't feel free, if they feel humiliated in their daily lives, you can hit them over the head once, twice, three times, four times, five times. But the sixth time, they will rise up. And I think what we've seen recently, unfortunately, in these unconscionable stabbings, is precisely that. Some Palestinians reach a point where they say, my life is worthless. I am going to end my life. They know their life is going to end. But I'm going to take one Israeli with me, maybe two. And if we don't want that status quo to persist, then what are the alternatives? Some people speak of one state. Prime Minister Netanyahu, beholden to the right with his one-seat majority in the Knesset. I mean, he's on the center right. He compared Rabin, of course, to Chamberlain and Oslo to Munich. And we all know what he just said about the Grand Mufti having given Hitler the idea for the Holocaust before he retracted that. But there are people in Prime Minister Netanyahu's government who, of course, want one state. They want to annex all or most of the territory. And there are a growing number of people on the Palestinian side who also believe in one state. Ladies and gentlemen, one state is untenable. It's not going to work. Look around the region. How good does it look for multi-ethnic, multi-denominational states in Iraq or Syria or Turkey, where the conflict has flared anew with the Kurds? You can't have a state whose celebration of the day of its independence falls on the same day as marking the day of catastrophe, the Nakba. No, the only conceivable outcome is a two-state outcome. But you'll say to me, what about the Palestinian side? What about all the efforts that have made over all these years? It is enormously difficult, and the sacrifices that need to be made on both sides in order to place the future over the past are huge. We have a Palestinian movement that is divided between Gaza and Fatah in the West Bank, an aging leader, Abbas, 80, who maybe has given up on peace. We have continued incitement on the Palestinian side. And I guess I'd be prepared to say, okay, Mr. Netanyahu, it's true, there's nobody to talk to. If I believed that Prime Minister Netanyahu had ever made a good faith effort to engage with, you have to start somewhere. Everything starts somewhere. If I believed that he had made a good faith effort to engage with the moderate Palestinians on the West Bank, when Prime Minister Salam Fayyad was busy building Palestinian statehood on the West Bank, cleaning up corruption, building, improving the efficiency of government, repeating again and again that Palestinians were ready to live in peace and security beside Israel. Prime Minister Netanyahu and the government spent their time trying to portray him as a unilateralist and an irresponsible man. Why? Because he spoke good English, he was well-dressed, he was educated. He was the Palestinian from hell, if you want the image of the Palestinian to be a violent jihadi or a violent Muslim. And Fatah also bore responsibility. They marginalized Fatah. But there was no attempt to engage with moderate Palestinians. They do exist. Well, President Obama watched all this, and when Prime Minister Netanyahu declared during the last election campaign that there would be no Palestinian state, President Obama said, okay, it's time for a reassessment. And we're in that phase of reassessment still. I don't think the US government wants to hold up a fig leaf behind which a process can take place that is not a real negotiation. But I think it is still important that in the last year of the Obama administration, that he not just throw up his hands and say, this is completely hopeless, nothing can be done. I spoke about, and I think J Street has to continue to work to try to advance this idea of two states. The situation I just described with the way the settlements are partly an American enterprise, and there must be ways to avoid having a situation where something that is against the declared interests of the United States government is in effect being subsidized. I think it would be a good thing if a marker was set down by the Obama administration which made clear what the administration regards as a viable two-state outcome. What has to happen, where the line more or less would be drawn. The administration said it was going to do it, but then it didn't do it when the negotiations broke down. And I think anything the Obama administration can say, like Jim Baker said a quarter century ago, that draws attention to the way the settlements are inimical to peace would be a good thing. The sacrifices that have to be made are enormous. For the settlers, most of them, to withdraw from the West Bank is going to be a huge undertaking, and that will be necessary for peace. Some can remain in areas contiguous with Jerusalem, but a lot of the settlements will have to be closed down. On the Palestinian side, Palestinians will have to give up on the right of return. 4 million plus Palestinians are not returning to Haifa, Tel Aviv, and elsewhere. These are huge undertakings for both sides. And of course, a solution has to be found in Jerusalem, which would guarantee access to the holy sites for everybody and would allow the Palestinians in some part or corner of Jerusalem to declare that Jerusalem is also their capital. This conflict wouldn't have been going on for 68 years if those things I've just described were easy. But they're not impossible. They're not impossible with leadership. It's leadership that's lacking. Right now, it's lacking on the Palestinian side. It's lacking also on the Israeli side. And right now, there seems to be no viable alternative to Prime Minister Netanyahu. But I do believe that one will emerge. And I don't know if you saw the advertisement in the New York Times this week from three former generals in Israel who all said exactly what the five chiefs of security in the movie The Gatekeepers said. I don't know how many of you saw the movie The Gatekeepers, saying that this status quo that I just described is untenable. And Israel's security, which will be guaranteed under anything we do, is not achieved by more of the same, but the security has to pass through a two-state outcome. And I believe the profile of the Israeli leader who will take Israel to that outcome, who will take Israel back to the founding ideas of 1948, is precisely someone in the Rabin profile, a general, former general, who gives Israelis the sense and the assurance that their security will be guaranteed, but who realizes that for that to happen, for that to be meaningful and lasting, there is no alternative to two states. Well, let me conclude with two things. One is some lines from a poet. I don't want to leave you too depressed, and probably I've depressed you rather than encouraged you, despite my South African optimism. It's very hard, in all sincerity, to point to concrete glimmers of hope, rays of light right now, whether in the wider Middle East or in Israel-Palestine. But things change, you know? Who would have foreseen what happened in South Africa? The major events of my lifetime were not foreseen by anybody. The fall of the Berlin Wall, 3 months before, nobody was talking about it. The Arab Awakening, nobody foresaw it. I lived in Berlin for 3 years. I would drive into Poland. I didn't know where the border was. I had to pinch myself to remind myself that on that very land, on that very territory, only a few decades previously, millions, not hundreds of thousands like in Israel-Palestine, but millions of people had been killed. And now I couldn't find the border. I looked for it. I couldn't find it. And of course, German-Polish friendship is one of the miracles of today. So these things happen, and often they come almost from nowhere. So even as we look at this situation that I've just described, we shouldn't forget that, and we shouldn't cease working for the ideas that we believe in. So coming to the politics of fear, which are the current politics of Israel-Palestine, succumbing to the notion that you can just kick the can down the road endlessly, and that that will somehow work out for Israel. Sticking to the notion, as Palestinians often seem to, that time is on our side. What time is on the side of the Palestinians? Look what's happened since 1948, when they were offered half the territory of Israel-Palestine. How has time been on the side of Palestinians now living in the rubble-strewn misery of Gaza and in the difficult situation on the West Bank? Palestinian leadership has a lot to answer for, ladies and gentlemen. It is time for responsible Palestinian leadership. Anyway, let me read you the lines of Yehuda Amichai from a poem called The Tourists, about redemption coming for all the peoples of the Holy Land only when a Jerusalem guide tells his tour group, and I quote, "You see that arch from the Roman period? It's not important. But next to it, left and down a bit, there sits a man who bought fruit and vegetables for his family." What's he saying? He's saying history is all very well. It produces beautiful things. Narratives may be stirring and moving. We may never agree. We will never agree on what happened in 1948. The Palestinian people will have their narrative. The Jews will have their narrative. What matters is the ordinary man who's bought fruit and vegetables for his family, the man who is ready to move beyond history, the man who is working in his own way to try and get over the trauma of the past. And I will end with my own little family miracle, just to prove that miracles do happen. My beloved uncle, Bert Cohen, who was professor of dentistry at the Royal College of Surgeons in London, commander of the British Empire, appointed by the Queen, immigrant in Britain from South Africa, a wonderful writer who became a scientist. He enlisted in the South African Army in 1943 in Johannesburg. He was flown up to Cairo, and he stuck around in Cairo for a couple of months, and then he was transported by ship to Taranto on the southern part of Italy. And he fought the entire Italian campaign, ending the war in the beautiful town of Bellagio. And he saw a lot of combat. And in 1944, he was in Florence, reconnoitering for somewhere that might be suitable for an infirmary. And a small bird landed on his shoulder. And that bird stayed on his shoulder for 6 days. He called the bird Ishbel. And the people of Florence thought that my uncle was a saint. They would come up to him and say, "Malei, un santo, you're a saint." And the women of Florence would ask him to bless their children. Well, you may imagine what Captain Bert Cohen, a Jew from Johannesburg, knew about a Catholic blessing. But he vaguely remembered the mnemonic, spectacles, testicles, wallet, cigar. And so was able to make a rough approximation of the sign of the cross. And during this time, an American officer came up to him and said, "Say, Captain, you have a bird on your shoulder." And my uncle said, "Yeah, I know. It's been there for 4 days." "You don't say. Do you mind if I take a photograph?" So he took a photograph, and it appears in my book, of my uncle on the banks of the Arno with Ishbel on his shoulder. And in his war diary, my uncle writes, "Not 5 minutes after the photograph had been taken, my bird took off and flew across the river, that, as the photograph shows, is at least as wide as the Thames at Westminster. I watched it as it flew southward without so much as a backward glance, and in less than a minute, it was out of sight. I stood, dumbfounded, and waited for several minutes before resuming a lonely walk along the right bank of the Arno. I felt bereft. Some 15 minutes later, as I approached the Lucchese, I was looking out over the river when I saw a bird flying in my direction. Unbelievably, it alighted on my left shoulder. "Where on earth have you been?" I asked angrily, but without being able to suppress my elation. To this day, the question remains unanswered. Well, I was in Bellagio on a Rockefeller Foundation fellowship. By the way, if any of you can ever get that thing, go for it. It's unbelievable. Bellagio is stunning. And with me there was the poet Mary Shibist, who since published a book of poetry she's working on then called Incarnadine, which won the National Book Award. And I told her this story, and she wrote a poem about Bert and the bird. And it concludes, "Saint good luck, saint young man who lived through the war, saint enough of darkness, saint ground for the bird, saint say there is promise here, saint infuse the fallen world, saint how shall this be, saint shoulder, saint apostrophe, saint momentary days, saint captain, saint covenant of what we cannot say." Thank you very much.
Okay, right.
Thank you so much to Roger Cohen. What an honor for our Center for Middle East Studies here at the University of Denver to have him here on our campus for this discussion this evening, which will now proceed to its second phase. We'd like to invite to the stage Jeremy Ben-Ami, Ambassador Gary Grappo, and Nader Hashemi. It'll take us a few seconds, folks, to get the microphones attached properly. Let me just, while that's taking place, welcome. While that's taking place, I just want to, sorry about that, Ambassador. I'll just mention that for those who were moved, as I was, hearing the words of Roger Cohen this evening, I do want to encourage you to purchase. We have not one, but two copies. Two of his books, many copies of two of his books, available for sale right outside the door this evening. The table wasn't quite set up when you arrived, but Roger's new book, The Girl from Human Street, and a previous book about Bosnia, now with the 20th anniversary of the conclusion of the Bosnian conflict this year, Roger's book, Hearts Grown Brutal, is also available for sale, and I believe that Roger would be agreeable to sign copies of those books after this discussion, and then we will have a reception. So, without any further ado, Nader Hashemi will now proceed with a discussion.
Let me just pose a question to Roger, and then get Ambassador Grappo and Jeremy Ben-Ami to sort of comment. Speaking of leadership, Roger, you mentioned the absence of leadership in Israel and in Palestine with respect to the Israel-Palestine conflict, but you didn't, I think, emphasize really the absence of leadership where, in my view, it really matters here in the United States with respect to the Israel-Palestine conflict. And many of us, you know, with the election of President Obama, had these huge hopes that this was an individual who really got it, who understood both the Israeli narrative and the Palestinian narrative. And once he came into power, this was our rare moment and opportunity. Then there was the question, well, he had to get reelected. We couldn't expect anything in the first term. The first term passed. Then, you know, there was the congressional elections halfway through his second term, and that passed. And so, you know, the big question here with respect to leadership and President Obama on Israel-Palestine is what went wrong. you know, you said given the political realities here in the United States, let's see if we can go a bit deeper and get you to maybe comment on those political realities and what we can perhaps hope from the next president. What needs to happen? What needs to change? So the question really is, you know, what went wrong in specific details with respect to President Obama's leadership to lead on this critical issue that, you know, affects all of us, particularly here in this room. Could you share your comments on that, and then we'll get Ambassador Grappo and Jeremy Ben-Ami to sort of comment on President Obama's legacy with respect to Israel-Palestine.
Well, as I think as, you know, the fundamental reality in U.S. politics, in the Congress, in the White House, is that there is a huge political price and a huge perceived political risk in taking on Israel, in being heavily critical of Israel, in confronting Israel head on, for example, on the settlement issue, even in saying, look, so long as these negotiations are going on to try and reach a two-state outcome, it is not helpful. It is really, seriously not helpful for there to be settlement expansion. And because of that political reality that I've just described, you see, I think, an American president, like President Obama, I have no doubt about his deep internal convictions about the need for a Palestinian state, nor about his deep commitment to the state of Israel. I think he wants, genuinely, he's not just putting it on, he wants two states living beside each other in peace and security. But what you've seen during the now 7 years of his presidency is surges of courage, or what looked like the beginning of courage, the Cairo speech, sending Secretary Kerry on those numberless missions to really try and explore the possibilities, but an inability to, I think, be firm enough with Prime Minister Netanyahu, or at the same time to convince the Palestinian leadership, which also has, I think, vested interests, at least in the West Bank, in the status quo, that now is the moment to try to move forward. I think the president 2 years ago at the United Nations said that the priorities of the rest of his presidency would be Israel-Palestine and the Iranian nuclear issue. Well, we know which one he opted for. And it took courage to take on Israel on that. And I think he did the right thing, and I'm pleased that he did it. And I think it was very important that J Street existed. 7 years ago, that wouldn't have been the case, that a Jewish organization existed in the United States that was ready to support that in any way it could. But I think the president maybe reasons it this way. I took on Israel on that. I've got no juice left to take on Israel again on trying to resolve the Israeli-Palestinian issue. Plus, I have the small matter of ISIS that I have to deal with right now. So what does that tell us looking forward? I think it tells us looking forward that changing that political equation in the United States is absolutely fundamental in a way that perhaps it isn't in any other conflict around the world to the chances of a two-state peace. And that's the only kind of peace I can conceive of. And I think it's worth recalling that the Irish settlement came at a time when the views of Irish Americans began to change. And there was a serious effort put into making the Irish American community strong supporters of that outcome. It's not in any way a direct parallel, but it is very important that there be space for the president to act in what the president perceives to be the American interest on this conflict.
Okay, Jeremy, you've been in the thick of this, right, this debate. Now that we're at the end of the Obama presidency, looking back on what happened, the lessons to be learned, the way forward, what are your general thoughts and comments on this particular topic as we look toward another presidential election and a future U.S. president?
Well, I'd say two things. One, I don't think that there will be a resolution of this conflict with a prime minister in place who is abjectly opposed to a resolution of the conflict. There is a limit to how much the United States can do. There's a limit to how much a president can do to push that prime minister. And I think that the effort that John Kerry put in, I think the vision that President Obama laid out were terrific. But with this prime minister, no president and no secretary of state, I don't believe, would have been able to push the parties towards a resolution. And you had a very weak Palestinian leader whose credibility and power had been eroded by the settlements, by the occupation over the course of the last 25 years. So you had a prime minister who didn't really want it, and a president of the Palestinian Authority who couldn't really deliver. And no matter how much the president wanted it, I'm not sure that that was the critical element. I think you've got to have something from the parties more as well. So that would be one thought. I don't think this can all be pinned on a lack of presidential resolve and leadership. But I would say, secondly, that the critical thing that Roger said is the perceived political cost of pursuing this kind of a strategy. I think one thing J Street is demonstrating over the course of these last 7 years, and hopefully the Iran case was really the quintessential example that people will point to, there in reality is far less political cost to taking positions that are pro-Israel, but are pro-diplomacy, pro-peace, pro-negotiation, pro-conflict resolution, pro-Palestinian, pro-a regional arrangement that achieves peace. That cost may be perceived because of the loudest voices in the American Jewish community to be high, but the reality is the cost is not so high. And in 2016, all of those who voted for the Iran agreement are going to find that their fears about what the cost was supposed to be are going to be a lot less than they thought. And I look forward to the battle in 2016 politically, when those who voted for the agreement are going to win re-election, and those who voted against the agreement are going to see some political defeats. And I hope we can turn this perceived political...
How do you know, Jeremy?
I'm telling you. Look at the political map. Look at the political map, and which are the senators who are in most trouble? Mark Kirk in Illinois, Ron Johnson in Wisconsin, Kelly Ayotte in New Hampshire. The people who run the risk politically in this upcoming cycle are the folks who voted against the deal. And we need, as a movement, and what J Street is going to be focused on, is ensuring that this political perception is finally upended, and we put a little bit to rest some of the sense that you can't take actions that move in the direction of peace and conflict resolution based on the best interests of the United States.
Okay, let me bring Ambassador Grappo into this conversation, because he's had a unique vantage point from a different perspective as a leading member of the Quartet group involved in trying to bring about an Israeli-Palestinian peace process. And so the question really is to Ambassador Grappo, given your experience as a member of the Quartet group, someone who's intimately involved in dealing with both Israelis and Palestinians, what are the lessons here for U.S. foreign policy, for a future president, that we can learn or should learn from the Quartet experience moving forward?
Well, just picking up on the comments that made by both Roger and Jeremy, leadership is so vital and critical to the success of any negotiation, or even beginning a negotiation. If we reflect back on 1979 and the Camp David Accords, what was it that led to the success of those negotiations? Well, you had two leaders who had, fortunately, the right chemistry, believe it or not, although it took a while to get that to work, and courage. And then you had an American president who was willing to sit down, basically lock them in a room, and say, you're not leaving until we get
days.
It done.
13 days.
Which was an extraordinary thing for an American president to do. But he was fortunate because he had the two leaders who could do a deal. And as you just heard, we don't have that today. And in the foreseeable future, and I don't care who is elected president, That's not going to happen until we have two leaders on the Israeli and Palestinian sides who have the right chemistry, who can work together, and the courage. I've also said that whatever deal is eventually reached, whenever that may come, is going to require enormously painful compromises for both sides. That's nothing new to anyone in this room, or certainly shouldn't be. I've also said that the two leaders who do that deal will not be leaders for very long. And, I mean, it's a tragic thing to say, but whatever agreement they negotiate will be, by definition, a very unpopular agreement because of the compromises that they will have to make, whether it's from the Israeli side on borders or Jerusalem, or on the Palestinian side with regard to right of return. So how they are going to manage to square this circle and to deliver a peace agreement that's going to be accepted but vehemently disliked, not just upon delivery, but for decades afterwards. Not unlike the Israeli-Egyptian agreement, by the way.
Which has held, however.
It has held, but on the Israeli side, they're generally acceptable
and of course, Rabin was assassinated even before the peace was finally worked out.
So I think that the lesson for any future administration is that you're going to have to pray that the right combination of leadership is present. Moreover, the involvement of the international community, and especially Arabs at large, is going to be extremely vital from the Palestinian side. A Palestinian leader will not be able to cut any deal, at least no one that I can imagine today, living today, unless that leader has pretty much full backing of Arab governments behind him. Now, today it's not going to count for a whole lot because the Arab governments are pretty disengaged from the Israeli-Palestinian conflict. They've got bigger fish to fry. Most of them are sharks with very big teeth. And they're not too concerned about this, which is quite a turnaround from my days when they would basically burn my ears with criticism of U.S. policy on this whole matter. So getting Arab governments involved, and it actually could be done today. If you look at the Arab Peace Initiative that was presented by then Crown Prince Abdullah in 2002, later King Abdullah, now of course deceased. It was a very courageous document calling for recognition of Israel once an agreement was concluded between Israel and the Palestinians, and called for cooperation on a number of fronts, economic, cultural, and security. Well, today, interestingly, most Arab, certainly all moderate Arab governments in Israel have common security interests. And there's no reason today why Arab governments and Israel can't be cooperating on shared security concerns. They're all facing the same enemies, every single one of them. Hamas is generally viewed today as an enemy by most moderate governments. Not all of them, but most of them. ISIS across the board for the most part, Al-Qaeda, all of them. And so there's a great deal to be gained. And once that security cooperation can begin and you get the interaction between the Israelis and the Arabs, it builds up the confidence that's necessary for Arabs to finally begin to accept Israel as a member of the regional community. Now, that's something that this administration, I don't think, has pursued sufficiently and could. It's one of the few opportunities that really exist out there today. And I would be hopeful that the next administration, assuming they're facing the same circumstances in terms of security in the region we are now, might be able to capitalize on that.
Okay. We want to get the audience a chance to sort of, pose some questions, but I do want to give a chance to everyone on the panel to deal with the bigger issue that is on everyone's minds today, and that's the ISIS crisis. And Roger, you've been writing eloquently, in your column in the New York Times after Paris about what needs to get done. You've been critical of President Obama's sort of approach to the conflict in Syria and its spillover into the rise of ISIS. And you've laid out an argument that, we need to be militarily involved. NATO has to be involved in trying to sort of deal with this terrorist safe haven in the heart of the Middle East that is now spreading mayhem, not just in the Middle East, but on the streets of Paris and now on the streets of the United States. But the question that I think many people have in their mind, and you've sort of addressed this in some respects in your columns and in your interviews, is, you know, what's the plan that will actually defeat ISIS at its roots and that will prevent us from falling into the trap that we fell into after 2003? I mean, tomorrow NATO could easily defeat the Islamic State and wipe it off the map. The question is, where is the Sunni sort of political movement or army that's going to hold the peace and sustain the peace? And that's essentially President Obama's argument, you know, that, you know, we could militarily solve this, but then we sort of repeat the lessons of 2003, and that doesn't get us very far. Mm-hmm. So could you respond sort of to that general argument that we're hearing from the administration, and that the American people are really divided over? You know, 50% sort of are more in favor of a troop deployment, 50% still remember very clearly Iraq and Afghanistan. Where do we go from here?
You ask the easy questions, Nader. Just on what the ambassador was just saying, I mean, I'd love to place my faith in the Saudis to be part of a solution in Israel. But, you know, the Saudis, if you look at ISIS, which is what we're about to talk about, I mean, the Saudi role, not only directly in 9/11, when, of course, most of the operatives on those planes were Saudis, its underwriting of Wahhabi and jihadi teachings through madrasas around the world, I think has, in my view at least, done, this is theoretically an ally of ours, done more harm, culminating now in San Bernardino, to the United States of America than, for example, the actions of Iran over the past decade. Iran, our enemy. So I just like to say that I have problems with trusting the Saudis to be valued interlocutors or a basis on which to build a peace. Well, I was in Paris in the immediate aftermath of the random shooting of 130 people in three locations in Paris, and I lived much or a significant part of my adult life in Paris. Two of my children were born there. I care deeply about that city, and it was in a shocked and subdued and angry state. It was full of strange emptinesses. It was, I felt, resilient but wounded. And during that week, I watched our president appearing in Turkey. I could perceive in him no real anger or indignation. Of course, body language is not everything. Maybe one should avoid over-demonstrative body language. I don't know. And his message was essentially that our strategy is working. And I thought the speech from the Oval Office the other night was much better, and of course I agree with him completely on the dangers of Islamophobia and the need to avoid it, the need to admit Syrian refugees who are fleeing ISIS and fleeing the Assad government. But I still heard, in essence, our strategy is working. And after the downing of the Sharm el-Sheikh Russian passenger jet, after what I just described in Paris, after the shooting of 14 people in San Bernardino, I'm looking around for the evidence that our strategy is working. And I'm not coming up with very much. And I note the fact that 14 years ago, after 9/11, the West agreed absolutely that an Al-Qaeda sanctuary, safe haven in Afghanistan, from which the 9/11 attacks had been organized, could not be tolerated. And we needed to go in militarily and remove that sanctuary. And that's what we did. We then had the disastrous distraction of Iraq. But people forget that for about a year in Afghanistan, things were going pretty well. So what is it that has happened in the past 14 years That means we now seem to think that it's okay that we can have the Islamic State controlling a border straddling area with 6 million people living in it, generating between $500 million and $1 billion a year in oil revenue. Now maybe we can cut that back. A place in which they can train, they can plan, they can organize, and they can say through the very existence of that territory, you see, here we are, we're strong. That is magnetic. It is magnetic to young Muslims in Somme, in Brussels, in Paris, in San Bernardino, and elsewhere. And you can be very sure that the Islamic State is not using this time other than to try to come up with things that will make the Paris attacks look like small fry. I'm sure they're working on chemical weapons. I'm sure they're working on weapons of mass destruction. I'm sure we're working very hard to prevent that happening. And it's a question, I think, of weighing the question you posed, Nada. We have the experience of Afghanistan. We have the experience of Iraq. We have a Kurdish proxy army. We don't have a Sunni proxy army. What are we going to do afterward? If we do retake that territory, what will we do? What will be the sequel to that? And I think you have to weigh that dilemma against what, to me, feels like more of a real and pressing danger than is being acknowledged. That is to say, the danger of allowing the Islamic State to go on indefinitely, because the president doesn't have a time frame for this strategy that's working. We're not talking 3 months or 6 months or 9 months or a year. We don't know what we're talking. I don't hear. I mean, this is going to go on and on for quite a while. So you're weighing, you know, all the difficulty of, and of course it wouldn't be just the United States. I mean, we would want to work with the Turks, the Kurds, with others, with any semi-Sunni proxy we could find. But making the decision that we are going to close this down, and we're going to close it down in a certain time frame, whether that, given the dangers that we've seen over the last month and a half, is more pressing, more important, more persuasive than the argument that we can't repeat past mistakes, and then what will we do? Well, everybody's going to come down in a different place on that. I mean, I personally, somewhat in isolation, come down on the side that this cannot be tolerated. We have to close down that territory and quickly. And of course I hear the argument, well, that's exactly what the Islamic State wants. They want an end of days, a conflict in such and such a place. That's what they're trying to lure us into. We all seem to know what the Islamic State wants. I'm not sure how we know, but we seem to know. Certainly the president seems to know, and that this would then be, this is what they want because it would bring greater recruitment. We also know that. I'm not sure how we know it. But just because ISIS wants something, if indeed they do want it, that to me is not necessarily a reason not to do it. We should do what is in our interest. And I think in this agonizing decision, and politics is about agonizing decisions, and being a columnist in a very minor way is about agonizing decisions that you have to write, put on in a newspaper, but they're often proved wrong subsequently. I come down on the side of the need to find a military strategy to take this territory back.
Okay, Jeremy, the question is really the same one that I posed to Roger.
I'm not sure I have much support on this panel, by
the way. Well, I mean, I'm detecting some tension in J Street's previous position with respect to the deployment of U.S. military forces abroad and the position that, you know, Roger has taken post-Paris. But the big question that we're all struggling with here is, you know, what do you think of President Obama's strategy with respect to ISIS? What could we be doing differently? What should we be doing differently? Or does the president have the best strategy?
Well, first thing I just want to say is that J Street does not have a position, so I will speak purely with my own personal take on this and analysis of it. Not on behalf of J Street. I share Roger's critique of the president's tone and messaging in the aftermath of Paris. I think that there was an insufficient speaking to the sense of fear and the general unease that everybody is feeling about what is happening. And I agree that this was not his finest hour in the way that in the aftermath of Charleston or some of the other more domestic challenges, he has really given voice to a lot of the national need. I don't think that he necessarily was up to it in that particular moment. That said, we end in different places. Roger, I think, outlined the balance of the factors on either side of the choice. I think what the president is ultimately saying is that a number of the factors that Roger outlined outweigh for him the attractiveness of a relatively short-term military engagement that would be necessary to take that territory, to defeat that particular force, against the long term of what do you do with it once you take it? If you break it, you have to own it and you have to fix it. And that is the lesson from these last two Middle East wars that the president took. I come down on the side of the president on this. I think that the Islamic State has been driven back, not massively, but there is a percentage of its territory that it has lost in the last 3 or 4 months to the Kurdish forces. The level of the air campaign has been ratcheted up, and it is losing assets, whether it is oil fields or its military assets or its trucks. I think all of that can be ramped up, and I think that's part of the plan. I do agree about the Sunni, the need for a Sunni proxy alongside the Kurdish proxy, but it's not clear who you work with. Yeah. And I think that's where the flaw is also in the political argument then of what happens afterwards, because I don't know who you hand it all back to when you've taken it. I think we've seen hundreds of billions of dollars expended. I think we've seen tens of thousands of lives lost, hundreds of thousands of lives destroyed by these kinds of military actions. And I'm not denigrating in any way the cost of the terror that is happening, but I believe that the human cost of another land war could dwarf the human cost of this terror. And that is the terrible balance that is on the shoulders of the President of the United States. It's a job that none of us would want, to have to make this kind of a balance and an equation. But I personally come down in a different place from where Roger does, where I would probably side with the caution of the President in the ultimate balance that needs to be struck.
Which, incidentally, is also the position of my newspaper in its editorials. I guess I also wonder, you know, what's the tipping point? Is there a tipping point? You know, is there?
There might be.
The Islamic State
there might be.
Does X, and then
but let's
our
play
strategy
out.
Is working?
Right, but let's play yeah. out then yeah. the next few months and see if the degradation happens, see what can be developed in terms of the international coalition, and not make the judgment today. Let's give it another month, two, three, and see where we're at.
I want to give the audience a chance, but I want to give Ambassador Grappo a chance to weigh in on what is in many ways the million-dollar question here facing the United States with respect to ISIS. What do you think of President Obama's strategy? What could be changed? What should be changed?
Well, it's easy to be critical. It hasn't worked. It's a failure, and it's pretty much abject failure by just about anyone's measure. Now, what do you do? As you know, I've tossed out a suggestion based on the fact that if you look at the fighters of ISIS, they're largely mercenaries. They're not Syrians. If you look at the moderate opposition forces, however you want to define those, fighting in Syria, they're all Syrians. And if we sort of want to galvanize these moderate opposition forces, which, believe it or not, are not few in number, they're about 70,000. Now they're spread over, by some people's estimates, over 100 different fighting groups. There are two very large ones, the Northern Free Syrian Army and the Southern Front, which comprise about 40 to 50,000. And then the rest are kind of scattered out, mostly grouped according to tribes, but generally considered moderate, so 70,000. And it always struck me how is it that a force of 70,000 couldn't take, of indigenous troops fighting for their country, could not take on a mercenary force trying to establish a state on their territory? And so perhaps if the administration went back to some of the memos of the early days of this conflict about supporting the opposition, and then throw in one little attractive tidbit. You, the moderate opposition, unite, we'll help you, we'll arm you, we'll give you the logistics you need, we'll help train you, we'll use our special operators, and you go after ISIS. You defeat ISIS in eastern Syria, capture some critical outposts, particularly Raqqa, their capital, most critically Aleppo up in the north, obviously Palmyra. You capture those cities, you control territory, we'll recognize you as the government of Syria. If that's not motivation enough for opposition fighters, that you can be the new Syria. And by the way, that you needn't abandon the fight against Assad. But I'm fairly certain if these moderate opposition forces were to be successful in taking on defeating ISIS, moving toward the transition government that complies with the Geneva communiques that were agreed upon several years ago, and declare themselves the new government of Syria, get American recognition, and moderate Arab government recognition would follow. How many Syrians do you think are going to vote for the defeat? Well, we already know that 5 million have voted, and they've left the country. And internally, you have another 5 million who just might move to the same area. And just by over a period of time, you would see an interesting migration, I think, of Syrians to the new Free Syria. And at what point does the new Free Syria overtake the Assad regime? So yes, probably stepped up American involvement, certainly in terms of commitment and leadership, galvanizing the opposition, galvanizing Arab governments to support us, and then being willing to take the political risk when the time comes, hopefully, of recognizing a new government. Then you have Syrians basically defending their country, recapturing their country, and hopefully achieving what Syrians want, which is a free and democratic Syria.
Okay, thank you. Let's go to the audience now. And just a reminder on the ground rules that if you have a question, pose a question. Please respect the right of everyone in the audience to sort of hear as many questions as possible. I don't want to keep Roger here all night, but we have time, I think, for several questions. And I guess I'll try and play Phil Donahue here by trying to give the microphone to people so everyone can hear. So there's two questions here right at the front. I'll do it.
Mr. Cohen, could you define... could you define what you meant by Messianic Judaism and why you think it's such a vital factor in what's occurred?
I tried to define it in my speech. I mean, in essence, it's the view that all of Eretz Israel, all of the land of Israel, between the Mediterranean Sea and the Jordan River, is Israel's. Why? Because it is. Because God said so. And so, by occupying this land, by moving into it, you're in effect enacting, carrying out God's will. And that, I think, is the essence of the religious nationalism or Messianic Judaism that we have seen becoming increasingly ascendant within Israel. And that creates a situation of lawlessness.
We're all agreed we should start fresh. However, the narratives of the past are the environment of the present and of the attempts at peace. Therefore, I wondered why you left out in saying that Jewish nationalism rose and is enemy of peace, which I agree with, why it rose in Israel, and that was because the disillusionment with everything else that was tried. In other words, unilaterally, you didn't mention unilaterally, you know, why do you underplay Israel leaving Gaza and an alternative history that could have been written on the part of the Palestinians to turn Gaza into a Lebanon of, you know, Palestinian state. It's half the state. And why don't you mention Hamas? And
I did mention Hamas.
Well, and the other thing is, what about no one? Why didn't you mention Clinton and the incredible effort that was used? Wait a minute. That the incredible effort that was carried out in Yitzhak Rabin's wake by Yehud Barak, and that was the cause of the absolute collapse of the two-state solution in Israel, because it didn't work.
Thank you, ma'am. Let me be clear. I mean, there have been colossal failures on both sides, and I think I talked about the immense failures of Palestinian leadership over decades. You know, like everything else in this conflict, we can argue, you can argue, the whole world can argue over what precisely happened that caused the Clinton effort to break down, or what precisely caused the Olmert effort to break down, or what precisely caused the hope that Gaza might become something else when Israel withdrew to fall into ashes and rubble. There are differing views on all of these. And I didn't intend, and I don't belittle the sense of disappointment and disillusionment on the Israeli side that is real. I don't see particularly why that plays into Messianic Judaism. I don't think there's any particular link between those failures and Messianic Judaism. I think, in fact, if there's a single factor that has played into that, it was the miraculous victory of 1967, the scrambled victory of 1973, the fact that these lands, Judea and Samaria, all of Eretz Israel, was now in Israel's hands. And a growing number of Israelis, saw this as God's will. You know, this was meant to happen. And that particular view, as I say, has been ascendant.
Okay, next question.
Absent from the excellent discussion that you've been having, and I commend your remarks, Mr. Cohen, very much for what you've said, is the role of the Soviet Union, or the former Soviet Union.
Russia.
This is the existential problem that we face in that area now. You have ISIS, or ISIL, as the president would call it, as the cancer in the middle of all this. And yet, what has been feeding the cancer? Has it not been funding from at least many Saudi sources, and also from the revenue from transferring oil through Turkey and being sold through Turkey? These are issues that I have not seen our administration address with any dispatch at all. Would you speak to this?
Well, I think I did mention the Saudi role in the growth of the ideology behind ISIS. And I think Saudi responsibility in the spread of jihadism and Wahhabi fundamentalist ideology is hugely significant. I think Turkey has been playing a very dangerous double game and bears considerable responsibility for the rise of the Islamic State. In essence, Prime Minister Erdogan has chosen to use the Islamic State as a vehicle against the specter in every Turkish mind for all eternity, which is an independent Kurdistan. So seeing the spread of Kurdish-controlled areas in northern Syria and also in Iraq, and I won't go into the details here, but Prime Minister Erdogan chose to keep the border open so that Islamic State recruits can move freely through Turkey. And it's only now that President Obama is putting pressure on our NATO ally to close that border down. That seems to me step one. And close that border so that people, recruits, cannot simply drive for a day and a half from Vienna and find themselves in ISIS land. But no, Prime Minister Erdogan chose to use the Islamic State against the Kurds, as a buffer against the Kurds, and that's been a very dangerous development. As for President Putin, well, I think it was a disastrous moment in Syria when President Obama set a red line against the use of chemical weapons. President Assad used those chemical weapons. The president sent out his Secretary of State to make an eloquent case for why a military riposte was necessary. French jets, fighter jets, were revving up on the runway and ready to go. And the president went for a walk in the Rose Garden and changed his mind. He pulled back. And President Putin then mediated the deal that saw the removal of chemical weapons. And President Putin was immensely strengthened by that. Soon after that, we had the events in Ukraine. And America's word was immensely undermined by that. And the meaning of American red lines evaporated with that. These were very serious developments. And I think, as I said, what you have in Syria today is a free-for-all. It's a complete free-for-all. Every single force in the region, Iran, the Saudis, Shia, Sunni, the Kurds, Russia, Russia and Iran's ally, Bashar al-Assad, Iran, they are all present. Not taking a decision is as much of a decision as taking a decision. And the president has tried, he has had one bottom line over the nearly 5 years of the Syrian war: we're not going to get seriously involved in any way. And that, along with many other things, along with President Putin's support of Bashar al-Assad, Iran's, that has played a considerable role in the destruction of the state of Syria, the emergence of the Islamic State. Look, for a long time, the calculation in the White House was there's no real strategic concern for the United States in the Syrian war. In fact, in some ways it's quite good. Hezbollah's engaged there. It's fighting. Maybe it's losing a bit. Some of our enemies are fighting each other. Let's just let that mess play out. Well, hang on a second. This does have very direct strategic implications for the United States. Has implications in California, has implications in the fact that we now have the Islamic State there, has implications in the fact that there are now Russian troops on the ground there, has implications in the diminution of the perception of the effectiveness of American power. There's no question in my mind that the biggest foreign policy achievement of the president will be the Iran nuclear deal, and the biggest blot on the president's legacy will be the Syrian debacle. And you take your pick as to which is more important.
We still have a book signing and a reception to get to, so I'm going to take three more questions, and then we're going to wrap it up.
I saw
one more question.
I think, is it Marilyn or Mission had her hand up right from the beginning? And as she has been smiling at many stages in this, I'm
curious.
Someone
like you lived
I'm
in Belgium
the
getting
smile.
There. Thank you. It's interesting, it's ironical to know that in light of what's happening in Iraq and Syria, that the Israeli-Palestinian issue should be a piece of cake, but it's not, as you convincingly told us. And I was wondering, after decades now of the famous two-state solution, aside from the issues of leadership, which there isn't, or lack of leadership, lack of Mandela, lack of Messiah, isn't there what's missing in the debate today when we consider the two-state solution? An interim mechanism for that ordinary man that you were talking before about. Mm. Interim mechanism that could be based on dignity and human rights, that could be sanctioned by a third party, with the presence of the international community, that could make the livelihood of those ordinary people in Gaza or in the West Bank normal, short of an ultimate solution. Mm. I don't see that part of the conversation. Is that something that you would like to respond or talk about?
Yeah, well, you're talking about, I mean, I think there could be measures and confidence building measures. There's a whole wide area of the West Bank called Area C, which Israel continues to control. You could imagine Israel relinquishing control of some of those areas. You could imagine Israel trying to facilitate all kinds of economic contacts. And I think it would be a good thing. I think it's difficult because, partly because there's a lot of mistrust and partly because Palestinians on the whole aren't interested in anything short of the dignity of statehood. They want statehood. That is their goal. And to say to them, okay, we're going to remove three roadblocks and we're going to facilitate your financing and we're going to make it easier to transport goods from the port in Ashdod to the West Bank. I mean, all these things, you know, Prime Minister Netanyahu, even at certain points, has said he would favor them. But I think they don't answer the basic Palestinian demand to be masters of their own fate and to live in dignity with statehood. So I'm not sure how far in practice those ideas can go at this stage when there's so much exasperation and impatience on both sides.
Just a comment. As part of the quartet, we would work on those everyday issues, making it easier for Palestinians to cross roadblocks or to even have the Israelis drop roadblocks, to get Palestinian businesses registered so they could export their goods, to get worker permits. These are just kind of everyday things to make the lives of Palestinians slightly easier. The Palestinian Authority was really never interested in discussing those with us, ever. To the fact that any of this was done, it was done on our initiative. We talk to the Israelis, see how far they might be willing to go. We go talk to the Prime Minister's office, get his response. There might have been one or two Palestinians very quietly, they closed the door, who would say, yeah, that would helpful. That would be helpful. Of course, I can't say that publicly because these were all seen as just half measures at best. What Palestinians wanted was their own state. What they wanted was the elimination of the daily humiliation to which they are subjected. And I saw this. I'd go back and forth across the roadblocks. And I'd stand there and I'd watch, you know, elderly people harassed by a young IDF soldier with a weapon who was in command and humiliated. People going to the hospital, people going to visit family relatives, trying to get kids to school that day. There's just a certain point at which you're not accepting anything but your own liberty and your own freedom to move within your country. And that's what Palestinians want.
Ambassador Grappo, on those very poignant notes, I'd like you to please our audience join me in congratulating and thanking our outstanding panel. So good evening. I'm Ivor Douglas. I'm the co-chair of J Street Colorado. It's really been a marvelously erudite, engaging, and very serious discussion. To Roger Cohen, to Jeremy Ben-Ami, to Ambassador Grappo, to our outstanding chair, Professor Hashemi, and to DU, who has been a remarkable partner and co-host with us, we are truly indebted. And I particularly want to pay some recognition to Elaine Salzberg and David Wall on our committee, who are our co-organizers for this evening. I challenge any of us to have sat through that without feeling a level of real personal engagement. Right? I mean, just look at this room. I haven't been to a discussion quite as somber, frankly, where I think people have engaged in a level of contemplation and thoughtful policy consideration at a very crucial moment for the world, for American foreign policy, and in some ways domestically as well. And I think in that way, each of us have connected uniquely with what we've heard tonight. I would argue there's some of us that are connected and passionate and need now to do something to remain connected. And there's others of us who came, were emboldened, heard something, and feel angry and upset and mad about something. And I want to talk about both of those in 1 minute. I'm in the former category, and I tell you where I connected. I grew up in a town called Springs. Springs is
just the same distance as Krugersdorp, where Human Street is, distant from Johannesburg. And the story of Litvak Jews who left, migrated to South Africa and then to Britain is my story as well, in a very personal way. And I left South Africa at a time that everybody was saying there'd be blood in the swimming pools in a most awful and racist kind of way, and yet had a vision, having met Nelson Mandela just out of prison, in a way that was inspiring and connected in a fashion that the story of our sacred land, Israel, it demands of us a level of engagement and accountability. And that's why we as Jews looked at the lights tonight and watched them burn down. It was actually remarkable timing. At the end of your panel discussion, the last flame expired. And
is that a good or a bad sign?
Roger, I'm going to ask you to expound on that, but not in verse. And I challenge us not to be affected by that. And if you are challenged, then I need you to join us in the space that J Street Colorado is creating in our environment. This is not a community where these discussions are readily held or engaged. And DU has been a remarkable coordinator and facilitator, and we need to expand our voices. Don't leave here without going online to jstreet.org or going to our Facebook page, J Street Colorado, and getting engaged. There are many new faces here. For those students in the room, J Street U is our active arm that's involved in advocacy, is involved in advancing the role of America in foreign policy in the Middle East. And then those of you who are going to be upset and angry, you heard things that didn't quite sit right with you, that maybe still made you feel passionate, but not in a way that you want to get engaged. To you, I challenge you not to walk away. This has been a remarkable forum, and I again thank our speakers, I thank the leadership that they show, and I thank DU. But you can't walk away from this, because the passion you feel is as important for creating discourse around this issue. And that's why we're here. That's the space J Street wants to create and has created. And we invite you to continue with us on this very important task at a time of consolidating the Iran deal and the leadership that with our partners, the community, we've shown, to doubling down on the president's legacy to demand American advocacy and leadership for a two-state solution in the Middle East, and ultimately to taking local leadership with our local representatives to be certain that the policies that are important in the interests of the Middle East and Israel continue to be advocated for. I thank you for joining us. Please join me again in thanking our remarkable panel and participants. Good evening.